I'm going to talk tonight, obviously, about the theology of the body and try to give you a bit of an intro to that. And lots of things fly under the title Theology of the Body, but I'm going to try to be precise about it. I wanted to share just a few images just to remind us how people think about the body these days or how they picture it. So this is one. I think this is from the inside of a gym. A lot of these I got from like healthcare, health club kind of environments. Be the boss of your body, right? So it's like your body is like a subordinate worker, maybe an unruly child or something. They're doing this ad campaign anymore, but I am what I make up. Interesting, right? Wait, are you actually comparing me to your cosmetic product? I think they are. Take care of the body. It's the only place you have to live in. I mean, this isn't terrible on the one hand, but on the other hand, it does make your body sound like, I don't know, your house, you know, which you can sell. It can burn down. You still exist. You know, it does make it, you know, is my body not me, right? My house is not me. Is my body not really me? And then this last one, I love how unsubtle it is. Just cut to the chase. It's a war, people, right? Body war. You know, fighting my body. I once did a search, I think on Amazon, this was a while ago, for just the phrase body war. All these things came up, diet books, exercise books, right? This like very adversarial relationship that we have with our body. So yeah, our bodies are problems to be solved. So John Paul II, when he did a theology of the body, was dealing with this kind of ambient cultural setting, this kind of confusion. And John Paul II realized that our bodies are complicated realities, unlike my hedgehogs, my human children, and me, and all of you, we're much more complicated than the other animals that have bodies are. And so part of what we have to come to terms with is that we are our bodies, but we're also more than our bodies, right? And so it's that both and, that I am my body, but I also can do things that other bodily animals cannot do. And so John Paul II has a number of basic convictions in the theology of the body about our bodies that help us kind of come to terms with our complexity. And the first one is, I call this fundamental idea number one, this is me, this is not John Paul II. If you page through all, you know, 500 pages of the theology of the body, you will not find him saying fundamental idea number one. But I think it is an idea that he repeats a lot, and it's helpful to wrap our minds around it. And this idea is that the body expresses the person, which, when you say it, almost sounds really basic. Like, the body expresses the person, okay. But what John Paul II wants us to understand is that our bodies make us visible. Make us as persons visible, right? So the only other creatures that God made that are rational like we are, that can think, that can have, that come to talks like this, right? That have freedom, like my hedgehogs wouldn't even care about this talk, much less like show up here voluntarily and be like, hey, this is interesting, right? Why? Because they're not rational, right? They can do a lot. They can do some things better than I can, like fall from high distances and not get hurt. but they can't think, right? But you can, right? So we're rational, and the only other kind of being that God made that's rational are angels, and angels don't have bodies. So we are rational persons that also have bodies, and so what we can do that angels do not do naturally is to express ourselves through matter, right? Through our bodies, express ourselves visibly. So this idea that the body expresses the person is actually really key to understanding things. And even though I didn't mean the pun, so this is my youngest, this is about 6 years ago, and she was four, and she always had a really idiosyncratic fashion style. If you look really carefully on her left, our right, you'll see a carabiner with a key dangling from it. That was like one of her things. She would attach this carabiner to her clothes. And I don't even think the key like opened anything, but she just like, yeah, would attach it on there. And like one thing I love about this picture is that she didn't realize she was being photographed. She just didn't care, right? Very unselfconscious. She's working hard there, drawing her little drawing. But like it's that picture is so expressive of who she is. It really captures like a lot of her personality. And how can it do that? Well, it's because she's expressing herself by means of her body without even realizing it, right? She's not trying to express herself. Her body is doing that for her automatically. And it's doing it all the time, like it's doing it for all of us, right? And so you get a sense of who she is as a unique person, even, you know, separating out her very distinctive fashion choices, right? You get a sense of who she is as a unique person just by looking at her and looking at her body. And so the quote there from John Paul II is, I think, kind of made visible by this picture. So the structure of this body, of the human body, is such that it permits the human being to be the author of genuinely human activity. Our bodies are fitted, so like she had this creative inspiration and she wanted to draw this picture and her body, it was equipped to enable her to express herself. She has fingers, she has a face, she has all the things that she needs. God gave her all of that. And it's helpful to realize when we're thinking about this fundamental idea how there are countercultural things that go against this idea. So in something like transgenderism, for example, which is something that I've, you know, been doing a lot of work on for obvious reasons recently, the conviction is that the body does not express me. In fact, a trans person is saying, I need to change my body to make it express me because it doesn't do it automatically. And so they'll use a lot of language of like, you know, like my real me is kind of trapped inside this body and I can't, it's, you know, like, so if I were identifying as trans, I would say things like, well, you know, I'm actually a man and I'm like trapped inside this woman's body and this woman's body hinders me from being able to express who I really am. And that goes exactly against this idea that JP2 is trying to help us understand. He's like, you don't have to change your body to make it do this very basic, important thing. It already does it perfectly all the time, whether you're sick or healthy, whether you're ugly or pretty or whatever, your body is already perfectly expressing you. That's what it was, one of the things that it was made to do. So this first fundamental idea that the body expresses the person. I want to say a little bit more about this reality of the person. And I have the Latin term there, fons signatus, which is JP2 gets from the Song of Songs. When he talks about the Song of Songs in Theology of the Body, he talks about the person being a garden closed, a fountain sealed. And in the Song of Songs, this is what the male lover of the woman uses to describe her. He says she's like a garden closed, a fountain sealed. And John Paul II took this to mean that it was a reference that the lover who's speaking in the Song of Songs recognizes the mystery of his beloved. That there's a mystery there that even though he knows her and he loves her, and yet there's still this mystery that he can't ultimately reach. And for John Paul II, that's the mystery of the human person, that we are visible, we express ourselves, and yet there's always more to express. It's not the case that a person, you can ever say, well, I absolutely 100% know this person through and through, that there's something like just graspable about a person. So that we are, in a sense, these garden closed, these fountains sealed. This is actually my child number one and child number five, back when child number one, this is about 10 years ago, I think. One of the things that John Paul II talks about that's very strange, at least I found it when I first read Theology of Body, was the idea of original nakedness. And he gets this when he's talking about the book of Genesis. And in the book of Genesis, before the fall happens in the second creation account, the narrator tells us, he describes kind of Adam and Eve and their relationship with God, and he says, and Adam and Eve were naked without shame. And then he goes on and continues the narrative and the fall and all of that. And, you know, like, when I remember, like, reading this before I knew the theology of the body, I was just kind of like, that's weird, you know, that he had to tell us that. I wonder why, first of all, they were naked and why he had to say anything about it. And in the theology of the body, John Paul II says that that verse captures, like, the essence of the state of Adam and Eve before the fall. Like, it's not only not weird and random the way I thought it was, but that it's actually kind of essential. And so the reason he says this is that he draws from the first creation account, where it talks about how God is viewing his creation. And in Genesis 1, it says, God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And so JP2 connects this idea of original nakedness to the vision of God seeing creation. So how does he do this? What he says is that Adam and Eve in the garden before the fall had a purity of vision that was similar to how God views us. And what he said is that when Adam looks at Eve and when Eve looked at Adam, that they saw the person of each other, right? Adam saw Eve as a person. And that what he saw, the data that his eyes were processing, was her body. And his point was that before the fall, the body of a human person was really revelatory of the person, and the one who was looking could really see the person. Right? So there was this purity of vision where instead, as we're going to see after the fall, instead of looking at a female body and having his vision distorted by lust or by anger or by, you know, some kind of sinful passion or feeling, that Adam simply saw the person, right? And so that Adam and Eve saw each other the way God sees us. And sees that it is very good. And so in this sense, this is why JP2 says that the original nakedness is, quote, precisely the key for understanding the biblical view of the person fully and completely. And so we see this when Eve is first made, right? Adam is alone and Eve is first made, and he says, this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. And he doesn't view her with lust or with anything objectifying, but just simply sees her. And so this is part of this first fundamental idea of original nakedness. And JP2 actually calls the body and marriage, Adam and Eve's marriage in Genesis, a primordial sacrament. And it's a kind of a complicated idea what he means by primordial sacrament, because he doesn't mean one of the seven sacraments that Jesus instituted, because we're back in Genesis. We're, you know, thousands of years before Jesus comes. But here's a quote where he talks a little bit about what he means by this. So he says, body refers to what is visible. It signifies the visibility of the world and of man. In some way, therefore, the body enters into the definition of sacrament, which is a visible sign of an invisible reality. So what does he mean by that? So he defines sacrament there. So if, you know, you're in a confirmation class and the bishop quizzes you, I don't think bishops do this anymore, but if they were to quiz you before confirmation, right, and say, what is a sacrament? If you were to say, it's a visible sign of an invisible reality that gives grace, he would say, good job. All right, excellent. You are prepared well. Here, John Paul II is saying, we don't have sacraments without bodies, right? If God just made us as angels, there wouldn't be sacraments, right? Because sacraments use the material world, right? They use matter. We can receive the Eucharist because we have a body, we have a mouth. We can be baptized because we have a body that you pour the water on. And so he says, the fact that we have sacraments at all has something to do with the body. But it's even more than that. He says, in a way, kind of similar to how it is that the bread that is transformed into the Eucharist, that its visible qualities reveal Christ, our bodies are doing something similar. They're revealing us, but he thinks even more, our bodies are in fact revealing God. And this is because he believes that when we understand, when we see other human beings and understand the mystery of another human being, that it's always pointing quietly, it's always gesturing toward God as creator. And so he says our very bodies are in some way kind of like a sacrament. That's what the primordial language means, kind of like a sacrament. He also talks about marriage in this term. So our bodies are like a primordial sacrament, but so is marriage when we mean marriage outside of and before the sacramental system. So he's talking about Adam and Eve, right? So this is before we have sacramental marriage. It's before Christ has come. And he says their marriage is like, in some ways, a sacrament. He says that their marriage is a sign that efficaciously, that means effectively, always, transmits in the visible world the invisible mystery hidden in God from eternity. How does it do this? So I'm gonna talk about in just a few minutes how the bodies of human beings always come in one of two ways. We're either male or we're female. And the really interesting thing about how higher animals have babies, how we reproduce, is that all higher animals, including human beings, need the opposite sex, need a member of the opposite sex to have a baby. If you think about it, this is very strange, right? You maybe had some snacks, had some drinks tonight. You do not need another human being for you to digest, right? You don't need to be like, hey, can you come with me to get some food? So like, I'm hungry, I want to digest, I need somebody to help me digest. No, we do it by ourselves, right? But this is true of all of our bodily systems are like this, right? You don't need somebody else to breathe or to have your blood circulate, but you do need somebody else to reproduce. It's kind of astonishing, right? And so what John Paul II sees in the Genesis accounts of marriage and the fact that God creates male and female is that male needs female and female needs male. And that means that we are pointing, our very bodies are pointing to the need for someone else. And so as I'm going to talk about, our very bodies point to the fact that we are made for self-gift. Because we only can reproduce through the self-gift of ourselves to another and vice versa. And so this is why he thinks that marriage can function as a primordial sacrament, a sign that efficaciously transmits in the visible world the invisible mystery of God. Why? Because God himself is self-gift. And so from the very beginning with Adam, the creation of Adam and Eve and their marriage, that is a revelation, a very kind of quiet, unclear but real revelation of the Trinity. The fact that God exists as a communion of persons. Of course, this means, as we'll see more when we talk about the fall, which I'm going to talk about shortly, if our bodies reveal us, that means that, you know, again, unlike my hedgehogs, like we can make free choices about how we allow our bodies to reveal us, right? And sometimes, you know, like sometimes this is just politeness, right? Somebody tells a joke that isn't very funny and, you know, my kids are really nice and they laugh at my joke even though it's not really funny, right? Like they're kind of like that's just being polite. But we can also tell real lies, and not only with our mouths, but also with our bodies. And so JP2 calls this, he loves to make up words and this or phrases, and this is one of the ones he makes up, the prophetism of the body. That the body testifies, he says, it speaks a truth that it itself, the body itself, is not the author. That's good. The body speaks a truth that it is not the author. So if you think about the prophets, right? Isaiah is a prophet. God comes to Isaiah, he says, speak my word. So the prophet speaks a word that he didn't make up, but that God made up, right? So who is the author of the words that we speak if it's not our bodies? Well, JP2 says it's the person, right? The person, you can speak words and your body is how you make yourself known, but your body doesn't originate those words, you do. And so this kind of revelation of the body, he says, man is in some sense unable to express this singular language of his personal existence and vocation without the body. You need the body to express yourself. You need the body to be a prophet, to say whatever it is that you want to say. Again, we're not angels, so we express ourselves through our bodies. And he, another phrase he invents, is rereading the language of the body in the truth. So he says, because we are persons, because we can think, because we can make free choices, we don't automatically tell the truth. We don't automatically speak a true word. Unlike, again, my hedgehogs, which pretty much are always just testifying to the fact, I'm a hedgehog. Like, they can't help it, right? They don't have the brain power, the choices to be able to do anything else. But we can, right? And so his concern is this idea that we reread the language of the body and the truth. He says we can misunderstand what our body is and what it's meant for. We can reread the language of the body poorly. We can reread the language of the body falsely. And therefore, we can speak a lie with our body and not the truth. And so this is especially relevant for John Paul II when it comes to issues around sexuality. Because we can view our sexuality as a matter of pleasure seeking or power and domination or any number of things, right? And reread the language of the body falsely, right? But JP2 says if we pay attention to the human body and read it properly, we'll realize that we're made for self-gift, that we only really flourish when we give of ourselves. We're made for love and commitment and faithfulness. But we have this option, right? We can misunderstand the body. And so this is one of our human tasks, to reread the language of the body and the truth. One of the things I think it's important to realize, like a kind of contemporary application of this, which, you know, JP2 is writing in late 70s, early 80s, how we communicate, right? Do we communicate primarily through screens, or do we allow our bodies to be prophets, right? Do we communicate through our bodies in the presence of people? I feel like I see this kind of scene pretty often where it's like, people are communicating right next to each other, like via screens. You know, they're like, hey, look at this text, or yeah. Which, you know, I mean, that's maybe neither here nor there. But it's easier for us to tell lies when we're not communicating in person via our bodies, right? It's easier. That's one reason I think why people are so rude online, because they don't have a person in front of them to like look hurt or whatever, and they just say whatever the heck they think, and they, you know, more outrageous the better. So I think one of the contemporary applications is that for us to worry less about curating our images online and more about allowing our bodies to be the prophets of ourselves with other people. All right, so all of that is relevant to that first fundamental idea that the body expresses the person. The second fundamental idea that I've already alluded to is that we are made for self-gift. All right. I really love this mosaic. This is where Jesus heals the leper in the Gospels. And I think, yeah, there's so much about it that I think is so beautiful. But what we see here is what John Paul II means by what he calls, in yet another phrase he invented, the spousal meaning of the body. The spousal meaning of the body is not that everybody will be a spouse, or that the spousal meaning of the body only applies to spouses. That's not what he's talking about. This applies to every human being. This applies to a little baby. This applies to a priest. This applies to you and me and everybody else. Namely, that our bodies show that we are made for self-gift. So again, he thinks that's in the mystery of maleness and femaleness, that the male is incomplete without the female and vice versa when it comes to generating new life. So all of this is like really sounds really wonderful, like especially when I get to the, you know, talking about self-gift, like it's all very beautiful. However, it might be your observation that you don't see like people just falling over each other, like trying to be generous and, you know, full of self-gift and so forth, right? Obviously, what we have, especially when it comes to sexuality, is a world that is fallen. And so a lot of what JP2 does in the Theology of the Body is to quote these words of Jesus. This comes from the 19th chapter in Matthew, where the Pharisees come to Jesus and say, Moses allowed divorce, and so what is your teaching about this? And Jesus says, Moses allowed this because of the hardness of your heart, but in the beginning it was not so. So Jesus himself sends us back to the beginning, which then John Paul II finds by reading what we see in Genesis about the truth of the human person. He's not, keep in mind, he's not reading Genesis like an evolutionary textbook or something. Like, how old is the earth and how many days did it create? You know, like those aren't the questions that the early Hebrews were interested in either. That's not what they're trying to answer in the Genesis stories. They're trying to tell us who is the human person and what are we called for? And what we are called to is greater than the kind of petty sinfulness that surrounds us, right? So in the beginning, it was not so. He discusses this beginning in terms of three original experiences, and we've already talked about one of them, original nakedness. So this is a lot of his exegesis of Genesis. If you know anything about Theology of the Body, you might know this stuff. So first of all, original solitude. So these are almost all from the second creation account. Genesis 2 and 3. Adam is created. He looks at all the other animals. He names them, and he realizes that he is alone. And this is usually interpreted as being a negative thing. For JP2, it is a negative thing, but it's also a positive thing. And the positive aspect of it is that Adam realizes he is greater than all the other animals, and that's why he's alone. Right? If I only had my hedgehogs to talk to, like, I would be pretty lonely. Why? Because it's like the negative side is that I'm lonely. The positive side is I'm more significant. I'm greater than my hedgehogs. Like, there's just more to me. I'm more complicated. And so that's the first original experience of original solitude. The second comes when God makes Eve, and Adam says, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. And JP2 summarizes this by talking about it in terms of a communion of persons, that we see this unitive love of Adam and Eve. And then lastly, original nakedness that I already talked about. So the purity of vision, where the body of Adam was a window to Eve for her to see the person and vice versa. It was not an obstacle. So we have these three original experiences, and what happens is that Adam and Eve fall, right? And what results from the fall are different disruptions, different fractures in relationships. And so obviously the first and most important fracture is that the relationship between humanity and God, that we no longer have that friendship with God that we used to have. But secondly, we have an interior fracture. That's the language that John Paul uses. So a fracture is like a broken bone or something, right? We have this, we are not in harmony within ourselves, right? It's like, I want to go get a third brownie from the table back there, but I know it's not really good. And like my passions are pulling me one way and my mind and my will is pulling me another way. And we feel like we're not integrated, right? We've got these conflicting desires. We also see immediately that Adam and Eve have a rupture within their own relationship. They start squabbling, which we never saw in Genesis until the fall. They start fighting with each other. And they also have a disruption in their relationship with the world, where now Adam has to work hard and it's difficult and he doesn't like it, and Eve is going to have labor pains. So Adam has labor, pains of labor in the world, and Eve has pains of labor in pregnancy and childbirth. So we have all of these disruptions. And one of the most significant things is something called concupiscence, which is it's up there. You can see it pretty well. I once taught a class that it was a class for permanent deacons, and there was one particular student who just decided he really loved this word and made a point of every single class asking some question where either he or I had to say the word concupiscence. You can think about him and the mystery of students. Concupiscence means disordered desire. It means, actually, it has a couple meanings in theology, but for our purposes, it means disordered desire. In other words, other people have disordered desire, and we have to protect ourselves from them. And so we see this right away in the Genesis stories where Adam and Eve put on the loincloths, the fig leaves, right? We know instinctively that we need to protect ourselves from others' disordered desire. One important thing about concupiscence that JP2 always wants to emphasize is that for John Paul II, concupiscence is fundamentally a matter of the heart. It's a matter of what we want. What is it we love, right? What do we really love? And that's the kind of thing that motivates us, like what we really love. It is not fundamentally a problem of the body. If we think again about the trans stuff that I mentioned toward the beginning of the talk, for a trans person, somebody who identifies as trans and wants to be in a different body, they think they have a body problem, right? What's their problem? They're in the wrong body. And so what's their solution? It's very technological. Lots, chemicals, hormones, maybe surgeries, like a lifetime, actually, of medical technology. And that's going to be your solution if the body is the problem. JP2 says, no, the real problem is our heart. I mean, obviously, we do have body problems. We get cancer or whatever. But when it comes to the moral life, the problem is what we desire. And we have a tendency to deflect the problem to the body instead of recognizing that it's a heart problem, right? That if it's a heart problem, instead of defaulting to technology, what we need is conversion, right? We need a change of heart. Right? And that's a much different kind of solution than a technological solution. And so this is our world, basically, right? We're trying to negotiate disordered desire in ourselves, in other people. And so this causes all of these ruptures. And in Genesis 3, we have what JP2 views as predictions by God that he tells Eve that your desire will be for your husband and he will dominate you. And so you have there kind of the male typical and female typical patterns of disordered desire, where for the male, there's a tendency towards lust and domination. And for the female, there's a tendency toward the kind of manipulation of like relationships to get like emotional security. Fortunately, that's not the end of the story, right? We have a beginning of the story, which is that God made us different, and we have then kind of how we are now, and we have an end of the story, which is that we have a grace way forward, and so that obviously is found in Christ, right? So JP2 emphasizes that Jesus comes to call the heart. He says he does not come primarily to accuse it, although there is, there are moments of accusation, but that his primary mission is to call our heart to this graced way forward. So in other words, go and sin no more, but the point is to go to this, be transformed to this fullness of life. So what are some ways that one can live this graced way forward? I think it's really helpful to think in terms of generosity and self-gift, and this can be reflected in finances, in fertility, and in communication. And I think it's really helpful to think of all of these because we focus a lot on the sexual, and I think that's important. But there's kind of like, we're whole people, and we have all of these different ways that we can grow in generosity. We can think about finances, like how can I be more generous with my money? Fertility, how can I be open to the children that God wants me to have? And then communication, can I truly share of myself to the people that are close to me? And ultimately, this is meant for us to go to the communion, the ultimate communion that God calls us to, which is the beatific vision or heaven, right? That we're trained in generosity and communion of love here so that we can live that way forever in heaven. And that's why he spends a good portion of the book talking about Matthew 22. In the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, right? So that marriage is not the ultimate goal to which we're called. And he's not saying, and Jesus is not saying here that, you know, you go to, if you and your spouse both go to heaven and, you know, you encounter each other in heaven, you're like, do I know you? Like, are you important? What? No, he's not trying to say that like somehow your marriage doesn't matter in heaven or something like that. But that in heaven, people are not getting married, right? There won't be weddings celebrated in heaven. Why? In part because marriage is about children. It's about future. It's about living together toward a generosity for the future. And in heaven, all of that is accomplished, right? We're in eternity in heaven. And so we aren't given in marriage, but marriage trains us for this life of this communion of life-giving love. It's also good to remember, though, that our bodies are part of this eternal communion. So in the Apostles' Creed that you pray when you pray the rosary, right? One of the things that we confess is the resurrection of the body, right? That we will be embodied after the last judgment. And so God doesn't intend our bodies to just be this kind of temporary thing that for whatever reason he thought was weird for us to have. But no, our bodies expressed us here and are this revelation and instrument of self-gift. And they'll continue to be that with the resurrected body in heaven, though they'll be different, which he spent some time talking about, but I won't talk about that here. I wanted to give you just a few resources. There's a lot of Theology of the Body resources, so this is not meant to be comprehensive. Rua Woods does a lot with education. And so if you're involved with education, even if it's just, religious ed here at the parish or at your parishes, like it's good to know about Rua Woods. They do some really lovely stuff. The Person and Identity Project, so personandidentity.com, focuses on questions around gender, and it's really meant for a Catholic audience. They have short videos, they have articles, they have all kinds of stuff that's kind of geared toward priests, youth ministers, parents, you know, people in the Catholic world who want to address the gender question, which is one of the applications of this. I have a few books. If you really like history, but you have to really like history, my book on Margaret Sanger and eugenics, and Margaret Sanger's eugenic legacy is on the eugenic background, the eugenic ideas of the birth control movement, and Margaret Sanger in particular, who's the founder of Planned Parenthood. And then I have a short book on contraception, what the church teaches and why, that in Boston, they give to the couples in marriage prep. So it's kind of like meant to be a kind of marriage prep or, you know, easier read introduction to the question. All right. I am all done, and I'm happy to hear your questions. So thank you very much.